Blog Talk Radio.
Well, this is Stephen Huszar, and you are listening to Pam and Dawn.
Hello, and welcome to the special edition of Christmas Movie Spotlight. I'm your host, Dawn Mack, and I'm here with my colleague, host, and wonderful friend, Pam. Hey, Pam, how are you?
Am I here? Am I really here?
Are you there? Are you everywhere?
Is this Memorex? Is this Memorex? Remember that?
Is it live or is it Memorex?
Yes.
Gosh, now that's like stuck in my head now. You remember that was like the commercial from back in the day.
Yep.
What, for cassette tapes, right? You know?
Yes.
Those were all the rage, so once upon a time. Everybody
yeah.
thought that
we're
was something.
We're not telling how old we are.
No, not at all. We're not dating ourselves on age at all, you know? Hey. But I'm sure there's listeners out there that know exactly about Memorex. They remember that commercial because played it every time you turned around. It just got stuck in everybody's head. Now it's stuck in my head all over again. Thanks, Pam.
You're welcome.
Well, today, Pam and I have a real treat for you. We are so excited to bring you our special interview with the incredibly handsome and immensely talented Stephen Huszar.
And she said his name correctly, even with her southern accent. I'm proud of you.
I'm proud of me, too. And to full transparency here, I'm southern. So Pam has a dialect that no matter how it's pronounced, she always gets it right. I'm in the South, and I'm always going to train wreck it. So I'm going, how do you pronounce this? And she has to school me often. That's full transparency here, folks. So I'm very proud of myself today. And Stephen, if you're listening, I hope you're proud, too, because I was really sweating. I was going to train wreck your last name. And I just as an additional disclaimer, I am a stickler for that because with having a name like Dawn, and I'm in the South, that's how I pronounce my name. But people a lot of other places, like Pam, for example, call me Dawn. And it's like, it's Dawn. It's put the on in it. Put some Southern twang. And
I just can't do it.
I know, and try as you might. And it would probably, with your Chicago accent, it would sound really weird. So just stick to what
it
you're
would.
Doing.
It would.
So anyway,
well,
don't
even let me try because you would just poke at me for the rest of my life with that.
Probably so, but honestly, that's one of the reasons why I try so hard to pronounce people's names correctly, because my first name has been mispronounced, according to me, so many times throughout my life. So anyway, but yay me, I got it right. But
you sure did.
Oh, wow.
Stephen stars in the Hallmark Channel holiday movie Undercover Holiday, premiering Sunday, December 4th at 8 p.m. Eastern, 7 Central.
And we are so excited and honored to bring you our interview with Stephen Huszar.
Enjoy the show.
Thank you so much for calling in, Stephen. We truly appreciate you taking the time out of your very, very busy schedule.
Oh, it's the pleasure is all mine. It's great to talk to you both.
Thanks. Oh, my gosh. We're just so excited to speak with you. We're both, you know, huge fans of yours. We've watched you in a lot of things. So what we're interested in, though, because a lot of interesting answers come out of this, is who or what inspired you to become an actor?
Oh, the infamous question.
Yes.
right. Boy, let's see. Well, my first experience acting, why don't we go back to that, was a long, long time ago, and I was in grade 2 in my elementary school, Brunskill School, back in a small town called Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, in the middle of Canada, in the prairie town. And I had the honor of playing Old MacDonald, and Old MacDonald Had a Farm.
Oh.
A school special, yeah. So that was my first experience up on the stage, and I had a blast, to be honest. And I think that sort of planted the seed. I just remember basically changing into the old McDonald character, and I was only whatever I was, 7 years old or something like that, I guess. So it was pretty exciting experience, and I remember though how important it was that I wanted to be the main character of a show and of performing, because one of my best friends, Roger, he was dressed up as my dog, the farmer's dog, and he was wearing this very, very, very hot, warm, furry outfit that he had to zip up, and he was acting like a dog the whole time on the play. And after we wrapped, or after the curtains went down and behind the stage, I remember him, poor guy, taking off this boiling hot furry dog outfit, and he was beet red and sweating, and I kind of looked at him like, oh boy, I feel so bad for you. But then I'm like, note to self, do not be a dog you know, in the next play or on film and television. Try to be the lead character. So I guess that was a lesson, and I guess it just planted the seed, and then funny enough, after that I had not done much performing at all. And I went into business school. I have actually a Bachelor of Commerce degree. I'm a finance major, and I actually started off in corporate America. And then I had a bit of a change of heart about 3 years into being in corporate America. I was a management consultant at the time with a company called Accenture. And I just said, you know, this, as much as I love what I'm doing, and I was very grateful for the job I had, because it was an excellent career in some respects, of course, but I just wasn't being fulfilled creatively, and I sort of did a quarter life crisis review of my life, and I decided, no, it's time to get back to old McDonald's. And so I decided to then start studying acting then. So, but I was still pretty young, you know, mid early 20s, so I had an opportunity to switch things around pretty quick. So so that's what happened. Yeah,
well, you know, as we have no doubt that you were hugely successful in corporate America, but we are so glad that you followed your heart and decided to pursue acting, because we think of all the movies and stuff we would have failed to miss seeing you in if you had stayed the original course, you know. So I'm so glad that Old McDonald was so profound that it just kind of led you back.
Yeah, here, here to Old McDonald.
Right. So now, every time I hear that song moving forward, I'm going to think about this story.
Right?
It's funny, you know. Okay, so speaking of characters, you played DC Comics supervillain Plunder in the series of Flash, to much critical acclaim, I might add. So now, flipping the script, if you could play a superhero, who would it be and why?
Oh, boy, that's an interesting question. Yeah, I've been thinking about that lately because, of course, superheroes are so popular these days.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like all the main ones are all cast already, so I have to think outside the box. But it's funny. I think it's interesting going back in time a little bit, to be honest. And I don't know if you'd categorize this individual as a superhero, but I really think Tarzan speaks to me in many ways. I love living out in nature. I'm a nature boy. I love sort of living off the land and camping out, and so. To me, ultimately, filming something like that a character that sort of lives in the past like that and very much connected to nature and the animals and the jungle would be just a thrill for me, to be honest. And I wouldn't have to memorize many lines because I don't know how much Tarzan spoke either. So he just grunted.
Right. Right. Yeah, that's so true. And I could see you actually doing something like that because you just seem like an outdoorsy kind of guy with some of the roles you've even played.
Yeah, I really do enjoy it. I can't talk about it much yet, I don't think, but my next role actually is going to be outdoors, lots of snow, skiing, avalanches. So we're going to have a lot of fun on this next one. So, yeah, I'm excited. Awesome. I'm always excited to be outside. There's something about shooting outside that just connects you to nature and grounds me as a person and also to my character. And, you do have to fight the elements a bit, though, of course.
Right.
I remember, I think it was the second or even the first movie I ever shot was actually in Canada in Regina, Saskatchewan. A Mary Higgins Clark book series turned into a movie called The Cradle Will Fall. I believe that's what it was. And it was minus 40. Now I'm trying to change that into Fahrenheit, but it was very, very, very cold. And actually, we had a T-shirt made up that said Mars is something like minus 38 or something, and Regina, Saskatchewan is colder, basically. And
wow.
We had the cameras were freezing up on us. And
everybody
crazy.
Had icicles
oh, wow.
on their nose.
Yeah. For Angie Everhart, who was Sylvester Stallone's wife at the time, she was one of the leads on the show, and I remember I had to pull her out of this car. I was a paramedic. She did not have to act being cold, that's for sure. She was definitely
yeah.
shivering.
Gosh. I give
so really,
you guys
yeah.
credits. I mean, you just stand your ground and you do what you need to do no matter what the weather or the conditions are. Kudos to you guys.
You got to do it. Yeah, the face freezes up. I call it the sort of the smiley, the when you smile when it's that cold, it's something funny happens to your face and you start – and you can't. The smile is kind of contorted, and you start slurring
yeah.
your speech. It's really interesting what happens when it's that cold outside. And then the flip
yeah.
side, of course, we shoot sometimes Christmas movies. Well,
mm-hmm.
For example, the one I believe we're talking about a bit today, in the summertime. So if it's a really, really,
yeah.
really hot day, which
mm-hmm.
happens a lot in the summer, and we're wearing our turtlenecks and gloves and mitts and jackets and toques, it can get a bit toasty in there. And you're,
yeah.
You're trying not to sweat, and you're trying to look cold. So, yeah, there's a lot of layering that goes on to that as well.
Yeah,
I would imagine somebody's walking behind you at all times, out of picture, of course, out of the camera view, mm-hmm. and having to stop and wipe your sweat every few minutes if it's that hot, you know, because you can't glisten
yeah.
when you're doing snow.
Yeah, I think I won. Yeah, exactly. And I think I had at one point, it's funny you mentioned that, I think I had a team of, I had a few people that would literally, their job would be to take my clothes off as quick as possible and put fans on me so they I would just stop sweating as quickly as possible. Yeah, it was quite the ordeal.
Oh, my
yeah.
gosh. That's too funny.
Yeah.
Well, you've
hey, but
produced
I love it. I love
quite
a
few projects. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, I just said I love every minute of it, so it's all good. It's all part of the fun. So.
Well, that's proof, you know, positive there, so...
Yeah.
You've produced quite a few projects yourself. How do you feel that acting has helped you become a better producer?
Oh, yes, I very much so. I think everyone, if possible, I would encourage anyone in the film industry to try to put their self in other shoes as much as possible, and the film and crew and casting, because it just gives you such a better understanding of what's happening. And I could say the flip. I mean, producing really gave me a better understanding of and respect for what everyone else does on the set. And I think in a way makes me a more respectful actor to others. Because sometimes often we only see a little bit of what goes on and we don't really understand what goes into a production. So that was part of the reason I got into producing as well. I just love the art form so much, and because I have a business background, it kind of made sense to produce as well, and so I think both go hand in hand, you know. And acting wise, I mean, it's not. I mean, it happens. I think it's starting to happen more now, but not. I haven't found a lot of producers that have acted before, so it's kind of nice having so much experience in front of the camera as producing, and I can. You know, again, I can really empathize with the character, with the actors and what they need and see things from their perspective. So it's really just about trying to understand each other's roles and being respectful of each other is really what it comes down to. So I find it helps both ways.
Well, you know, I think it kind of broadens and grows you more as an actor overall to be able to do different things and to be able to see, you know, gain the experience of what's going on behind the camera, in front of the camera as well, and being able to kind of pull that all together so it just makes more sense, basically,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
in the overall scheme of things. So now Pam and I are one of millions of legions of fans of Chesapeake Shores that was so sad to see the series come to an end.
Yeah.
And I'm sure if you've been on social for any period of time after that final episode, it was expressed over and over and over.
please let it continue. But on an up note, we loved your character of Luke. And, I mean, he was so relatable and believable to viewers. And how much of yourself did you bring to the character?
Well, first of all, thank you for saying that about the show. And just, you know, and whoever else is listening knows it was just as hard for us as the cast. Final episode and to know it's finishing. We really, I mean, I was only there for 2 seasons. Gratefully, I was, you know, I was brought on. But you can imagine the rest of the cast for 6 years. But we all were such a close family. And they really brought me on and made me a part of the family, which I'm forever grateful for, to have that experience. And, of course, shooting in such an incredibly beautiful location throughout the summer is just really a dream come true. So it was very, very difficult for us as well. So just so you know. it was incredible. Relating to my character, Luke, I mean, gosh, you know, what we try to do as actors is obviously pull on as much personal experience as we can, because that would, you know, that would make it a very grounded performance, because we have those elements. And then, of course, elements that aren't there, we'd have to research and try to exist in it as much as possible to make it real to us, of course. So, you know, luckily for me, luckily and unluckily, I suppose, I've had loss in my life. I lost my father at a younger age as well, and I've had friends that have had issues that are similar to Luke's, addiction issues, I've experienced times in my life where it's just, you know, one little thing you do can just set you off in a direction you would have never thought of, you know, good and bad. Mm-hmm. And we just don't know where life is going to take us. And it's sometimes just those, if you look back on those instances, you often wonder, well, what would your life have been if that didn't happen, or mm-hmm. if it did happen? Yes, very relatable in a lot of ways. And I just really enjoyed putting myself in the shoes of someone who had that unfortunate experience and really had to live through this and had to come to terms with this situation and how is he going to get himself back on his feet. And ultimately, in the end, really having the support of family and friends is really, really such a huge part of that. And I think that can be, we can relate that to any situation we're in all walks of life. And that's what I really enjoyed about his character, or my character, Luke, and how that related to all the other characters in the show and how they really supported him. And it was, I think, a very strong message that was sent and a great, just such a profoundly well-written couple seasons by our wonderful writers, Steve and Mark, who really pulled something extraordinary together. So we have so much thanks going out to them, really. It's really them, and we just have to flow that through us, you know? We just speak their words.
Absolutely.
So,
And, you know, I have to say, between Dawn and myself, she's more of the crier than I am, but I even cried in the last season a couple of times.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, both happy and unhappy tears at certain points, depending on where I was in the story. But if the story were to continue for Luke, what would you like to see happen?
Oh, boy. You know, it's funny because I never really thought of that. Because we knew it was ending, so you ask tough questions, but challenging ones. I like it. What would
you
like to happen? Yeah, well, I mean, I think it just for him just to really find his feet a bit more. I think he's still a bit of a drifter the way it is. He's getting there, and he's certainly has had the opportunity to help out Mick, for example, and his issues, which I thought was very noble of him, and perhaps just sharing his story more with others. You know, that's ultimately, I think, in real life, what a lot of people go through when they go through a tragedy or something challenging like this in their life, and they have a story to tell, to actually share that story, because more often than not, you're gonna touch people that relate to that. And could really, really help their life, So that would be an interesting storyline, really, to have him perhaps share his story more in whatever, however he can, or whatever platform he can. And that would be, that'd be interesting to see where that would go.
Yeah, and you know, I think you make a great point, because I think that's one of the reasons why it's been so hard for the fans of the show to just let go and say, okay, this is final, because we could all see so many different storylines continuing onward in so many different directions, you know, spinoff series and so forth. And I really hope, sincerely, if Hallmark, you know, is thinking about doing something along those lines, which obviously would be a win-win for everybody involved. But there are just so many things they could do with the series. And one of the things I feel like that could have more exploration is your character, because I feel like from the time he started, you know, in the previous season and continued onward, it really was a progression, but the, you knew there was so much left to tell. Like, how were he and Bree going to end up? Were they going to get married? What was going to happen? So there was so much more story left, and so hopefully we'll see that play out as time goes on. Speaking of stories, we cannot wait to see you in your upcoming Christmas movie, Undercover Holiday, and it's going to air on Hallmark Channel this holiday season. And so what can you share with us about the movie without giving too much away?
Yeah, that's a tough one, too.
Yeah,
the hard part.
Hopefully we won't have to edit too much of this. Yeah. Let's see. Well, I'm really excited about it as well. I just want to let you know it was a blast to shoot. We just finished. We just wrapped, actually, a few weeks ago, so haven't been hasn't been too long, so it's pretty fresh. I had the great honor of working with Noemi, who's just a fantastic actor. I'm sure fans, or some fans anyways, who recognize her from Selena, the series on Netflix. Just such a force to be reckoned with, a beautiful talent musically as well as acting and performing. So we had so much fun, and honestly, I think the soundtrack is going to blow people's mind away. So I just want to plant that seed right there, because there was some beautiful tracks being laid that I had the opportunity to hear while we were shooting as well. So I'm excited for that. Just want to drop that seed. Let's see, what else can I tell you? Well, I play a bodyguard, I'm basically hired by the label, the record label, who represents Noemi's character, Jalen, to protect her, because she's getting some a little unnerving, let's just say, unnerving messages that are being sent to her place, and she doesn't know who they're coming through from. So they just want to make sure she's safe, and I'm brought on, and you can imagine the interesting roller coaster ride we go through, as I have to be with her every step of the way, every day, throughout the Christmas season. So it's quite fun. A lot of humor, a lot of, but also just, you know, a lot of some intense moments as well. And with a lot of the Hallmark movies, there's very, very strong family values that are set up in the show, and to have such a diverse cast and a great storyline was just a pleasure to work with everyone there. So I feel very blessed. Yeah. And the Spanish that was being spoken on set was phenomenal. So I picked up a few words as we went. So it was great.
The good words.
Yeah, the good words. Yeah. Well, you know, that's the bad words, but mostly good words. Yeah. Mostly, yeah. Feliz Navidad was a big one being said.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we're looking forward to it. It sounds like it's going to be a fun movie. And we do know Noemi. How did you say her name? Noemi?
Oh, Noemi. Yeah, I just think Noemi. That's how she explained to me to pronounce it. So, yeah, Noemi. Yes.
Yeah. We actually were fans of hers from The Young and the Restless as well, because we're soap opera fans.
Oh,
we watch soap, so we know who she is,
yeah.
And she's very, very talented.
She sure is, yeah. So fantastic, yeah. We had a wonderful – it was actually her first time shooting up in Canada as well, so I think hopefully it was a positive experience for her as well.
Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure. Just being with the cast alone and the story and the line and the movie, she'll be around a lot more, I have a feeling.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Now that you have a successful career, what advice would you give your younger self?
Oh, my younger self. How young?
Well, I don't know. As young as you want to go. Let's say 16.
Okay. 16. Oh, wow. Okay, let's see. 16. I was still high school. All right. Well, I mean, you know, it's interesting for me is now you know a little bit about my backstory of how I didn't necessarily follow my dreams right away, but then I ended up following my dreams. I really do believe that if you believe in your dreams and what you want to do, it will come true. Now, I had to face a lot of obstacles in my life. I basically had to do a 180, and then you can imagine leaving one of the best jobs you can have in corporate America and telling people I'm going to become an actor. And, you know, it just didn't ride so well for family. Not everyone, of course, but it was a big shock. So, you know, in the beginning, I didn't have a lot of people on my side, but I just knew that I needed to do this and I needed to do it for myself. So if there, you know, if anyone is out there who does have a desire to really do something, and just, I would say 100%, just keep doing it. It might take a little bit of time. It didn't hit right away for me. It actually took quite some time for me to have a consistent career, if we can put it that way. But you know, just don't look back and really believe that you can do that, because I do believe that is true. Nothing can really stop you if you believe it. So that would be my number one advice.
Well, that's great advice, and that can apply to anyone at any age, realistically, because I think we all have to keep dreaming and having goals and achieving, you know, setting goals that we can achieve and shoot for. That's kind of what life is all about.
Absolutely.
So, and it's what makes it very special, too.
Yeah, 100%. And especially if it comes from the heart. Like, if you truly know it and you feel it, if you're not just doing it because someone else told you, you know, if you truly believe that's what you want to do, that's what's going to really keep you driving through those times where it might be challenging, or, you know, it seems like no one's on your side, or it's just not happening right away. You need that light inside you to keep going, or else it's just so easy to do something else, right? There's so many options you can do in this world. You know, we're very grateful to live in the time we live in, because there is a lot of opportunity for us all, you know.
That's true.
But it's to have that light in you and saying, no, I'm going to keep going, I'm going to keep focused, that's sometimes challenging, but that's why it has to come from the heart, you know. Absolutely.
That's really right. Well, before we wrap up, we want to play a little five-question lightning round. It's all Christmas-themed, and there's no wrong answers, by the way. So it's not a pop quiz.
Perfect.
So the first one is, what is your favorite Christmas tradition?
Christmas tradition? Well, opening a present in front of our fireplace back in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan with my family. Now, it's interesting because I come from a European background, so we open up our presents on Christmas Eve. So Santa Claus comes a day early, which makes sense because he's got a lot of territory to cover.
That's right. And you want to make sure he doesn't miss you.
So you get to do it
the day before. And then just spend all day Christmas enjoying, you know, each other, which is always a good thing to do at Christmas.
Yeah, and you can also sleep in the morning as well.
That's,
you know,
right.
Yes,
that's
true.
That is so true. See, that's so well thought out, right? All right, what is your favorite Christmas song?
You know, I really love Jingle Bells. That's mine.
All right, what is your favorite Christmas movie?
Christmas movie. I really love The Polar Express. Have you ever seen that with Tom Hanks?
I have, yeah.
Old animation.
It's a classic.
Oh, that's a great one.
Timeless classic.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, most definitely. All right, hot toddy or hot chocolate?
Oh, hot chocolate.
And white lights or colored lights?
Colored lights all the way. Are you kidding me? Yeah.
this concludes our lightning round. And, hey, it was great. Thank you for playing along.
You had me sweating for a second. Yeah.
It really helps when there's no wrong answers, you know.
That's right.
Yeah, you know, when you said that really disarmed me, so thank you very much.
You're welcome. And we want to thank you again for joining us today. We truly, truly appreciate you taking the time out. I mean, it's just been a thrill speaking with you.
Oh, I feel the same way, Pam and Dawn. Thank you for having me on your show, and have a great rest of the holiday season.
Thank you, and you as well. Be blessed.
Thank you so much. All right. Have a good night. Take care.
You too.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Hey guys, don't leave us yet. Be sure to follow us on Twitter at Christmas Movies, that's XMASMUVIES, and also like our Facebook page at Christmas Movie Spotlight. Don't forget, that's spelled MUVIES. And follow us on Instagram at Christmas Movie Spotlight.
And don't forget to check out our website, ChristmasMuviesSpotlight.com. That's movies with M-U-V-I-E-S, ChristmasMuviesSpotlight.com.
Thanks for listening. See you next week.